Hello, everybody. It's Sylvie. Welcome or welcome back to Tarot Magpie. I hope you are doing well. Today's video is going to be the second installment in my collection series, in which I'm showing you all of my tarot and oracle decks, as well as all my tarot books. So last week I did my oracle deck collection, and today I am doing my indie tarot deck collection. This one is going to be a long one. I have many decks. So strap in. I hope that you're ready for a feature-length film equivalent for collection video. This is everything that is currently in my collection that is an indie tarot deck here at the start of 2024. All right, these are going to be in no particular order because the fact that we have split them into oracles, indie, and mass market is order enough. I'm just going to dive in and show you what I've got. All right, the first indie deck that I have here is the Neo Rider Tarot Collection, and this one is the Gluttony, I think. And this has actually shown up in a couple different videos as a deck that I don't use because it is so slippery. But this is the Rider-Waite-Smith, Pamela Coleman-Smith's line work on this hot pink metallic plastic cardstock. So that's my issue with it, is it's the kind of plastic that is just falling everywhere. So I don't use this, but I do love it, and I have plans to, like, I have some of the cards out. This could be my altar deck. Oh my goodness, why have I only just connected those dots? Okay, so I am gonna start using this as my altar deck. Right, next we have another pink one. This I actually recently showed in my last 10 decks video. This is Zeke's Arcana by Zeke's Lunchbox. We've got more pink in the edges and these fabulous holographic accents on the back. And I believe this one is now, or will very shortly be, out of print. So apologies if you're seeing this for the first time, but the reason I bought this one I did was because I heard that she was closing up shop and isn't going to be selling these decks anymore. So act fast if you want it. But this is beautiful. This is a new one. Like I said, it was in my last 10 decks video, which I put up last week, I think. So I haven't had much of a chance to play with it yet, but I think it's fantastic. It's very evocative in the pips anyway, in the minors. It's pippish, but it's still very evocative of the Rider-Waite-Smith, in my opinion. Like, I think here with the grapes and the bird, this is very, very Nine of Pentacles to me. It conjures up that Rider-Waite-Smith image really easily. The majors go in their own direction a little bit, as to the quartz, but I still think it's beautiful, and it is still quite evocative of the Rider-Waite-Smith, but very much in its own style, as you can see. This is definitely got its own thing going on. I love it. It's bright, it's colorful, it's alien sci-fi vibes. Somebody left a comment saying that this deck has, like, grown-up magical girl vibes, which is 100% accurate, and I adore it. All right, my next stack of decks is my Tarot Collectibles collection. So I have quite a few of these. They do Rider-Waite-Smith clone slash redraws. This one is not showing up very well because it has this sparkly overlay, but this one is the Groovy Waite. So I was checking the edges because I colored it in pink. This is the Groovy Waite, and as you can see, it's the Sparkles edition. I hate these backs. Sorry, I don't know why I'm here to poke holes in a deck I otherwise really enjoy, but as you can see, it is a redraw, a themed clone of the Rider-Waite-Smith artwork. I love this Three of Swords. I think this is one of my favorite Three of Swords cards. But yeah, it's gorgeous. It's fun. It's very similar, I'm not going to lie, to a couple of other decks that I have, which I will show you now. Okay, so this is the Trippin' Waite Borderless Edition, which I have shown on my channel a fair few times because I really love it. I have this one wrapped in this scarf. The bags that I've shown so far came with the decks or were bought alongside the decks from the same creator. This is just a silk scarf I got from a charity shop. But this one is not shiny, which makes it a lot easier to see under the camera lights. But this is the Trippin' Waite. This was my first tarot collectibles deck, and I fell hard in love and have amassed quite a little collection since. And as you can see, it's similar vibes to the Groovy Waite. This one I think has more detail. Like, I love the fabrics, and then it's got all these swirls and rainbows. The backs are also a little bit more inspired. I love this Queen of Swords with the butterflies. I think it's just, it's absolutely fantastic. The color palette is also a bit bolder and richer, which I think is aided by the fact that the Groovy Waite with the sparkles looks much more like pastel-y. But yeah, I just think the colors in this are so, so gorgeous. I love these backgrounds that we've got. I think it's beautiful. Okay, this is my latest tarot collectibles acquisition. This is the Spring Waite, which came out this year. I backed it on, I think it was Indiegogo. I think I backed it earlier this year and it came out in the summer. This one is another sparkly one. But I really like how the dots on this, I don't know if the camera's going to pick it up, how they look like pixels almost. I think it's really cool. So this, I did a walkthrough on this when I received it. So go check that out if you want to see all of the cards in order. But this is the Spring Waite. It's got rainbows. It's got Easter vibes. It's got loads of like bunnies and butterflies. One of my favorite cards is, I think it's the Six of Cups, that has cows in the background. And like here we've got like Easter. It's very, very springtime, but particularly it feels very British springtime, like with the daffodils and the bunnies and the cows and stuff. And I adore this Two of Cups. I adore the colors and the little cow in the background. So I think we'll leave that there. All right, this, oh, let's not knock the coffee. This is one of my favorite bags from them. This is the Judgment card. And as you can tell from a little sneak peek of the bag, this is Aliens. This is the Psychedelic Space Tarot. Again, it's a Rider Waite Smith redraw, as they all are. This one has this outer space, aliens, sci-fi vibes. But as you can see, the bright neons, I don't know how well the camera is picking them up because they are true UV reactive neons. This glows under black light, which is so cool. I love all the eyes in the lion's mane. I think this one is so much fun, and I love the neon colors. And the sci-fi vibes. I'm very much a sci-fi fantasy kind of person with my reading and watching tastes. So I love to see a deck that reflects that, and it feels very kind of like campy sci-fi, which I enjoy very much. But again, it's very loyal to the Rider Waite Smith because it's a clone. So it's just really fun. We're still going with the tarot collectibles, and actually there's a couple more, but they are elsewhere in the giant bag of decks next to me. I've organized these videos by putting my entire collection into big reusable shopping bags, so things are a bit jumbled. But this one is the Deadweight Apocalyptic Survivor. I've shown this off a few times as well because I think it's really cool. I really like the backs on this one. This plaid back I think is really nice. But this is a zombified Rider Waite Smith, and my favorite thing is how each card is different with the way the edges have been like torn or burned or have holes in, or they're all bloody. So the theme of the deck is this zombified Rider Waite Smith, but also the deck itself is supposed to look like it's been through an apocalypse and is all battered and bashed and like fingerprints and stuff. It's so much fun. Again, like the alien, the psychedelic space. And like I said in a video not too long ago, I think it was in my 5 tarot decks video or 5 tarot decks challenge. I think that if you're a Rider Waite Smith reader, at least, you should have a fun Rider Waite Smith clone. Like, look at the zombies in the water. Because sometimes you want something that's easy to read, that you know how to read, but just that looks a bit more fun or is a bit more interesting. So yeah, that is my Deadweight Apocalyptic Survivor. The rest of these, there are a couple more tarot collectibles decks, but they're, like I say, somewhere else in the bag. So I truly am pulling out random. This one is the Oh God, why do I always forget the name of this? Oh, it's the Toiling Hands. The Toiling Hands Tarot, or the Tarot of the Toiling Hands. This is made by a UK creator, which is really nice. So are the. Well, they're in Ireland somewhere. I can't remember if it's Northern Ireland, and so if it's technically UK or not, but for me at least, the shipping is not ridiculous, which is nice. But this is a UK creator, and it's this black and white. She's a tattoo artist, so it's this black and white tattoo style deck. I really love as well. My favorite thing about this is the titles that are on each card. So here we've got the Knight of Cups, the Benevolent and Romantic Soul, and they're not titles that are, they're not like the Thoth titles, they're not titles that exist anywhere else, as far as I'm aware. So I think that the titles that she came up with as she was creating this deck, which I think is very, very cool. Like Eight of Cups, the Child of Escape, and the Master of the Missing. Like that's so, so evocative, and I really enjoy it. The God of Clear Cognition for the Queen of Swords with my butterflies. It's really, really beautiful. I will say I've got this and I've got one other black and white deck. I don't struggle to read with it exactly. It's just that my eyes, I struggle to visually process it when I've got a lot of cards because it's only two colors and the style is so consistent throughout the deck that at a glance, it's hard for me to read. Like I say, it's hard for me to visually process it, which is as much, if not more, a me issue, and just the way that my brain works and I process information. I'm not saying that that's a fault of this deck specifically, but it is a factor in how often I do or don't use this. So I really want to pay more attention to this because it's really, really cool. All right, this is the Tarot of Aphrodite from Natasha Fromm. This was the edition that was on Kickstarter. I think the first edition of this that was on Kickstarter early this year. Oh, Aphrodite on top. I know there's been, I think because this was really popular when it was shipped, that she didn't have a lot of additional copies and there was a lot of demand for it. So I think it's been a second edition, but she's changed some of the artwork because this is all made up of existing artwork in the public domain. She's changed up a lot of the artwork and I think maybe reduced the borders and maybe also crisped up some of the images. And so I'm really glad I have my hands on this first copy because I like the soft haziness of the images. I think that's true to the paintings. You know, they're old paintings, they're not photographs, and I like how fuzzy and soft focus some of them are. And I don't mind the giant pink borders because I love me some pink. I really, really like, look at that beautiful ace of coins. I love this deck. I've said before, I've got a soft spot for Venus, Aphrodite. So I love this. I love pink. I love the historical art style. I've got a few historical art type decks. And I really love how this one reads. It came in the early summer and I read with this outdoors a fair bit. Like Justice holding up a mirror, I think is such a fantastic choice. I love the choices because this is all existing artwork, like I've said, but everything fits the card just really, really well. Some of them have been renamed, like we've got the Seer for the High Priestess. Aphrodite is the Empress. Aries is the Emperor. I think the Fates was the Wheel of Fortune. I just think it's so, such a beautiful deck. It really is. And I'm very happy that I have it in my collection. And I'm also very happy that this is the edition that I have because I think I prefer it. Although some of the changed art choices are really nice too. All right, this is the Autonomic Tarot. This is the full 78 card deck. There was an earlier edition that had the majors and then I think some additional cards. I think there was about 30 cards in there. But this one is the full 78, and we've got pips for the minors, except for the aces and the tens, which are illustrated. And then obviously the quartz, also illustrated. I just love this deck. I love the art style so much. If I did the like goth punk decks tag that was going around, I don't know, ages ago, at least a year ago, I think, this would be like top of the list. I love the style. I love the woodblocky style. I love the color palette that's used. And it's just, it's kind of weird and wonderful. And I can't get over how much I love the artwork. I think it's fantastic. The only issue with this for me is it's slightly too big to comfortably shuffle, which is unfortunate. This is another UK-based production. So it was really nice and affordable for me because I'm in the UK, but shipping to or from the UK is just a complete nightmare. So I think as a deck base price, it's quite affordable. And I think that is reflected in the quality of the cardstock in the box. Like, it's not bad by any means, but it's not the most luxe cardstock shuffling experience that I've ever had. Which, like I say, I'm perfectly happy with because of the price that I paid. This page of discs is wonderful, and that's where I'm going to leave this deck. Oh, I don't know actually if the earlier edition that was, like, do you see what I mean about the quality of the box? I don't know if that's picking up, but I opened it and it like kind of started falling apart quite literally immediately. But I don't know if the smaller edition is still in print or if it's out of print or what, but this one I got again relatively recently. I think it came to me in October, and there is an unboxing and flip through on my channel. Okay, this adorable little deck is the Lifelines Tarot by Thomas of Hermit's Mirror. I've shown this and its sister deck, which is also somewhere in the bag. I've shown them off quite a lot. So this is a redraw of Pamela Coleman Smith's line work, but with like one single continuous line. So like, as you can see here in the Three of Swords, there's lots of details that are missing and you've just got the swords and that's kind of it. Some of the cards are a little bit more instantly recognizable than others, but I really like how in the minors, the focus is on the, you know, the swords or the pentacles, and you don't necessarily get so many of the background details. And so you can read what's missing as much as what is actually there. Like, this is a pretty traditional looking judgment. I wouldn't have to look too hard to clock that as a judgment card or like the star. But then some of the, like this Ten of Swords is just the swords. And like at first glance, I might confuse that for like the Nine of Wands because you just got lots of vertical lines. But anyway, it's really, really cool. And like the way that the people are missing in some of the cards or are just like empty space, like here, we've just got a little hand. I think it's really cool. And I don't reach for this copy as much as I used to because I do now have the sister deck. But I definitely need to bring this out more as my travel deck of choice because it is very, very cute, and I really like reading with it. I am unsure if this one is still in print. This is my only Majors Only deck. It is the Occult Ornithology Tarot by K.S. Waite, who is another UK-based creator, which is really cool. So this is just, well, it's actually a 24-card Majors because we have an alternate Strength and Justice with the Rider-Waite-Smith, no? With the Thoth numbering or the Marseille numbering. And I preferred the Rider-Waite-Smith images. So that's what I have in my deck. It has this gold foiling, but the way my lights are set up, it's really hard to see. But the titles are there, I promise. And in real life, they're not that hard to read. I had had my eye on this, like just on the general internet for quite a while. And then when I was at Comic-Con, she had a stall and was selling this deck, and I simply could not resist, so I didn't. I love it. I love the yummy, yummy color palette. I think it's so beautiful. I think our art style is amazing. And it's my only Majors Only deck, but I'm glad to have it because it's nice. It's a nice thing to have because you can always take your Majors out of literally any other deck, but you know, that's effort. And sometimes the barrier for me doing a thing is really, really low. So that's on neurodivergent brains. But I must not have only just now be noticing this, surely. But we've got the elemental and the astrological symbols in here as well, which is really cool. So like Venus, Earth, Pluto. Have I only just noticed this? I'm not sure. But anyway, that is the occult ornithology. All right, this is upside down. This is the woven, oh, there you go, the woven path tarot. This was a Kickstarter I backed toward the end of 2022 and that I finally received in September, I think, of 2023. Look, the gilding, I haven't really used this deck much, but can you see the gilding is already like fading in the middle of the deck where I shuffle. This is a deck that was created by 78 different artists and it has a medieval tapestry kind of vibe to it, which, like, this is a good example. Some cards are more obviously following that kind of aesthetic than others, but they all work really well together. And these cards are also lovely. They have this beautiful spot gloss, which I think is really effective. And also I think I prefer to gilding on card faces, maybe. Like it's a bit more subtle, but it still pops. Sorry, I was lost in thought admiring the cards there for a second. So I haven't really reached for this deck a whole ton since I received it. And I'm honestly not too sure why, because it's beautiful. I'm really, really happy to have it. And when I have reached for it, I've enjoyed reading with it. I think it's just a case of too many decks, too little time, which is why I'm going on a bit of a low buy depth year this year. This Justice is beautiful with the additional arms. I think that's very, very cool. Like, do you see what I mean? Like this on its own, like a whole deck in this style, I wouldn't think medieval tapestry, but it also works in combination with the rest of the deck. This is a very cohesive 78 artist deck and I just think it works really, really well. So I want to put more of a focus on this one because I was anticipating this for so long. I was so excited for this deck. Originally, we were going to be getting it in, I think, May, but then there were issues and delays, which is fine. I honestly never expect a Kickstarter deck to turn up on time. I'm really pleasantly surprised when it does, because especially post-COVID, there's shipping issues, there's delays, and I'm in the UK and a lot of Kickstarters are from elsewhere, so I have an extra time to get it to me anyway. But I was so excited about this for so long that when it finally arrived, I almost like didn't know how to feel about it. But it's gorgeous and I definitely need to focus on it a bit more. Oh, and that death card is just fantastic. But I don't want death on top of the deck to jump out at me whenever I next open it. Oh, and these are the backs. Like, how beautiful. I love the tone of gold they've gone for, but it is already wearing off the edges, which is a bit of a shame. Oh, this also came with a set of Zodiac cards. I don't remember if this was, I think this was originally, like, this wasn't like a stretch goal. I think this was the original pitch for the deck. Okay, perhaps unsurprisingly, this video has eaten all the space on my SD card in my camera, so the last clip cut off, but hopefully not in the middle of me saying something interesting. Moving swiftly on. This is the Naturescapes Tarot, which is a deck that I got off Make Playing Cards. It is still available. She's also done a Architectural Objects Tarot, which I also want because I love this, but this is a deck made of photos of landscapes and of nature. And I am surprised, not surprised, pleasantly, I'm pleased with how accurate these images have felt, how evocative they are when it actually comes to readings, because I'd seen this around on YouTube, I've watched a couple of flip-throughs, I've seen photos, and I was like, yeah, these images make sense for the card. Like, that they're depicting, even though obviously a lot of them are quite abstract. But I'm like, you know what? Yeah, this is a Two of Wands. I see it. This is a Seven of Swords. I see it. But then in actually reading, when I pull cards and have, you know, three, five, however many laid out next to each other, it makes sense on a whole other level. Do you know what I mean? Like, you can look through a deck and say, yeah, those images fit with how I interpret those cards. You can like or dislike the artwork, but then when you actually come to read with it, it can be a bit of a different experience. Like, there's Five of Wands. And just like the power, the intensity, the atmosphere, the gravity. Gravity is the word I'm looking for. The gravity in this judgment is fantastic. So yeah, this is a really, really great deck, and I am really pleased that I have it. All right, this was another Make Playing Cards deck, and I've put this under the indie category, although arguably I'm not sure. So this is a reproduction of a mass market deck that is out of print. This is the Crow's Magic Tarot. So I put this in my indie deck video because I got it off Make Playing Cards. This specific copy was independently published independently put up on Make Playing Cards. It doesn't have the borders that the original copy of the deck does. And I just think this is so cool. This is one of those decks that was like a unicorn deck for me. Or like a dream out of print wish list deck, because whenever I've seen a copy pop up on eBay, it's been more money than I'd be willing to pay. So when I learned that there was an edition up on Make Playing Cards, I jumped on it. I don't believe that you can get this anymore, which is a shame if you want it, but I think probably understandable with like copyright things. So anyway, this is the Crow's Magic Tarot. This is the Lilifer Tarot. This is the second edition that was on Kickstarter this year and that I received in September, I think is when I got my copy. And this is the gold edition. So it has some gold foiling on the front and on the backs of the cards. I love these backs, by the way. And this also has numbers and titles, which I think were maybe not on the first edition of the deck or were much harder to read. I'm not sure. I missed the first edition of the deck when it was first. I think it was also a Kickstarter deck, so I'm not too familiar with the details, but this is really beautiful. This is the same creator as the Reclaim Oracle, which I showed last week in my Oracle deck collection, and it's the same kind of blobby people, but this is watercolors, I think. It's really, really beautiful. I really like the artwork. I love how it is fluid because of that watercolor, because of the gradients, but also it feels kind of punchy almost. Not punchy, but like solid. It's not kind of dreamy and faded and wishy-washy like some watery colory type decks are. Like, it knows what it's saying. Like the images, I don't know, there's something in there. Maybe it's incorporating this line work as well and the details. I'm not sure, but I hope you can kind of understand what I'm getting at. Like, it's fluid, but it's also solid. Anyway, that is the Lilifer Gold Edition. I love the size of this. This is one of my favorite tarot sizes. Like, it's slightly shorter than your standard tarot, but it's like small, but not too small. It's perfect. It's like the Goldilocks of tarot sizes. Okay, this is a Marseille, and I put the, because I've only got a handful of Marseille and one Thoth deck, I just put them in with my other tarot decks because otherwise that would be a really short video. This is my only indie Marseille. And this one actually has all of the additional cards to make it a minket or something. Like the planets and the signs, which is really cool. But this is the Dinosaurs de Marseille. This is on Etsy. I believe it is still available. This is another UK-based artist, which is really cool because it meant I didn't have to pay an arm and a leg for shipping. And I think this is just fantastic. I got this after I fell for the Squid Cake Marseille back in April, and then I did a little Marseille for May, and I was using this and Squid Cake and reading my Marseille books and trying to learn. I was like focusing on learning Marseille during May. Obviously, I did not learn the whole system in a month. We've got the volcano for the tower, which I think is really cool. So it's pretty faithful to the Marseille, especially in the pips, I think, with the orientation of everything, but it's been reworked. So obviously there's dinosaurs all the way through it. I love that we've got evolution instead of the wheel as well. And paleontology for the judgment card, I think is really clever. But the orientation of all the pips, I think, is consistent with the Marseille tradition. We've got crinoids for the pentacles or the coins. Natural selection. That's clever for the sun. Ferns for the air suit, for the sword suit, as well as flying dinosaurs. I think it's fossils for the wands suit with carnivores. And that's a fern. No. Ammonites and herbivores for the discs, and then crinoids and water dinosaurs for the cup suit. So it's fun, it's playful, but it is consistent with the Marseille and even the like person cards. The only actual human person is that paleontologist, but for the majors and for the courts, they've been styled in a very Marseille way, and I think it works, you know? I love that we've still got, like, a dinosaur riding a dinosaur for the knights. So this is a really fun, really fun Marseille. These are the backs that I really love as well. And again, it's that gorgeous, like, size. Okay, the Fellman Sisters Tarot. I think I did an unboxing of this. No, I definitely did. This was a Kickstarter deck that came in, I think it backed and then came in really quickly in the first half of 2023. I'm just now realizing that I might have been saying this year a lot when I mean 2023, but this is going up at the beginning of January, so I think you get what I mean. And this is a street art inspired tarot by the Feldman sisters, who are street artists in Ukraine. And I think the publisher of this deck is in Ukraine as well. I might be wrong. But this is just so weird and wonderful and has this like early 2000s word art, like with the gradients created in Microsoft Paint kind of vibe that I love. This feels like quite nostalgic, and it takes a lot of liberties with the Rider-Waite-Smith, which I don't think is a bad thing. So it's just like this is a pretty recognizable Eight of Pentacles, but then, you know, you come across like the Six of Cups. I think this is a really cool, really effective Six of Cups with the like repeating, and this looks like a like time travel kind of vibes, but it definitely does not look like the original Six of Cups, and if you didn't have the numbering, you might be hard pressed to figure it out. But this is just really, really cool. It's definitely weird and wonderful. It's probably a bit of an acquired taste. I love this Hanged Man. Like, it's odd, but I love it. Pentagram Publishing. Yeah, which I'm 90% sure. Yeah, it's made in Ukraine. I'm 90% sure it is a Ukrainian publishing company. And I believe they've got quite a few decks, actually. I think they do quite a few Kickstarters, so you've probably heard of their other projects, if not this one. This is the Dream Vision Tarot, and this is the second edition. This was a 2022 Kickstarter deck. Look, 2022 was the year I discovered Kickstarter. This is the beautiful Lover's card sitting on top. Like I say, this is the second edition. I believe what was changed was the titles. I think they were pretty straightforward, like either at the top or the bottom. And they're kind of worked into the artwork in a way that I think is really cool in this edition. And it's also got these matte blue edges. These are the backs. I think the art style is just so beautiful. And that's about all I have to say. I think the colours are gorgeous. I think the art style is really beautiful. I like the way that the people are kind of alien looking. I also really like reading with this. I think it's beautiful in a spread. I think it's reminiscent enough of the Rider-Waite-Smith that it's easy to read. The little guidebook that comes with it, I don't really dig into. Oh, this sun is just beautiful. I don't really dig into the guidebook, but it also does have the Deccan that each of the minor card represents, and it has the like planets or the signs for the majors. There's a little bit of astrological information in the guidebook, which I think is pretty cool. But yeah, this is honestly kind of like a nice straightforward reader. I'm really looking forward to bringing it back out again in probably the spring, summer, or maybe even the early spring, because today it's absolutely freezing and I'm already restless for warmer weather, and we're in like the second week of January, the first week of January. I don't even know. But yeah, so this is the Dream Vision Tarot. Oh, she came out with a, or at least on Kickstarter, I don't know if the actual deck is out yet, she did an Egyptian themed tarot in the same beautiful art style. And in the end, I didn't back it. But, and I'm okay with that decision. But this deck was available for purchase quite easily online somewhere. It might be Tevada Tarot. And so I'm kind of hoping that the Egyptian one also will be, in case I change my mind. But anyway, this is the Dream Vision. My beloved Terra Volatile. I talk about this deck all the bloody time. It is maybe my favorite deck that I own. It's just so readable. And I find it so easy to read, but not because it's a, it doesn't give simple answers. It's just that I connect with the artwork in this deck so deeply that I'm not going to say instantly know what it means, because let's be honest, we always have cards that stump us. But I just find it so easy to dig into the symbols in these cards and read them. Like, I just find this so readable. I think I've only just noticed these two birds here. How have I only just noticed these? Like, there's so many details in these cards. This one is really cool. It comes with a bunch of additional cards. So the base deck has a fifth vessel's alchemical suit. It has alternate cards for some of the cards like this here. I've got two women in the Two of Cups, and I'm sure that there's a version with a man and a woman and two men. And there's alternates for a lot of the majors and the court cards. You can have pages or princesses. And I also have the expansion. So I'm saying this and I'm not sure which of those variants are in the base deck and which of them are in the expansion. But like, this is a more Marseille style lovers, and there's a more Rider-Waite-Smith style lovers somewhere. I have this, I have the expansion. I think it's beautiful. I love the art style. I got myself the book, the guidebook, the big, heavy, beautiful, glossy, illustrated guidebook when that came out. I love this deck. I will stop talking about it because I talk about it all the time, but if you want to see in action, I did my soul card reading. It was the soul reading spread that was bouncing around Tarotube, I want to say back in the summer sometime, maybe. And I read with this, so there is more of this deck on my channel. I'm speaking this into existence. I'm going to do a sort of second impressions mini review of this deck and the book, but I need to dig into it a little bit more, as well as the vessel suit, which I keep putting off using. But once I am a little bit more familiar with the alchemical suit and with the guidebook, I'm going to do a second impressions review kind of a video, because it's my favorite deck. I have to have a dedicated video to it on my channel. I fear we are only about halfway through. This is the Lifelines Tarot Color Outside the Lines edition. So it is the sister deck to the mini Lifelines that I showed. And this one was a limited print run. So I think this one is out of print, Like I say, I'm not sure about the mini edition. These are the backs. It is the same line work, but with added colour and in a bigger size, and comes with a guidebook, which the mini edition didn't. I love this. This is a deck that I reach for when I feel overwhelmed, or when I don't want to feel overwhelmed by a deck of cards. Because some artwork is a lot, sometimes there's too much symbolism, there's too much going on. I just want to kind of cut through all that and just get some straightforward messages. And this deck is perfect for that. More so than the mini one. Because like I was saying with the Toiling Hands, if I just have black and white images in front of me, and this, again, like it's extremely consistent artwork throughout the deck because it is all single line drawing, that can be a little bit visually difficult to process with the mini deck. But because this one has color in it, it's easier to see what I'm looking at, if that makes sense. And it's such a good deck. I also really love the little guidebook that comes with this. I don't want the Three of Swords sitting on top. Let's have something happier. Let's have a Knight of Pentacles sitting on top. So it's got some spreads, which I really like the spreads in this book. The mages are really good. We've got a description, and then there's this oracle guidance and an affirmation, which I just really like. Like, it's short and sweet. Unfortunately, the minors are just like a sentence, which is a bit of a shame. I really wish that, like, it would be almost a perfect guidebook if we had this kind of setup for all the 78 cards. It is not the first guidebook to put a lot of attention on the majors and not the minors, and it won't be the last, but it is still a really good guidebook in its own right. This is the Way Home Tarot. This is another kind of spacious, easy to read, not drowning under layers of symbols and imagery kind of a deck. This deck is so good. It is almost people-less. We have these silhouettes in the court cards, and it's daughter, son, mother, father, rather than page, knight, queen, king. We've got these silhouettes, and then they're filled with the element that they represent. I love lightning for the wand suit. I wish that was a more common thing we saw in decks. I just feel like there aren't enough decks that utilize lightning as a wand's symbol. But I just think this is just such a clear reader. I feel like it cuts to the meaning of the card really cleanly and really easily. I love, love, love the pentacle suit in this deck. Is it the 9 or the 10? The 9 of, like, this is my favorite 9 of pentacles of all time. It's just gorgeous. But yeah, this is a really beautiful deck, and I would not be without it. And similarly to the Color Outside the Lines, this is easy to read in the sense that it's straightforward to read. This, the Terra Volatile, is easy to read in the sense that I know what it's saying. Does that make sense? Like, they're both easy to read for me personally. You know, we all have our personal connections with decks. They're both easy to read, but in different ways. And I don't mean that this is easy to read because it's not saying much. I've had some very deep, very meaningful readings with this deck. It just very quickly gets to the heart of what it's saying. This is the Eldritch Overload Tarot. This was a Kickstarter, but you can still buy this. It's still being printed. It's not out of print. I did a walkthrough of this when I received it. It's a cyberpunk, fantasy, sci-fi, futuristic, holographic feast for the eyes. It's also like RPG inspired. You've got the fantasy sci-fi vibes, but also the separate guidebook you can buy has a D&D compatible module, and there's nods to the like fantasy D&D style storytelling narrative all the way through the deck. It has such a strong sense of world building. Like, I'm not sure I own another deck that has such a clear sense of world building. It's true to the Rider-Waite-Smith, but also is very much set in its own world. You have all these different characters, and I will be honest, having the big guidebook really helps to realize that and put those pieces together. But because it's this, it's also a setting for a D&D module, you've got a world, you've got certain characters and species of people, and it's just really effectively, really cleverly done. I'm a big sci-fi fantasy person. I love to read sci-fi fantasy books, so I really appreciate the kind of storytelling that's in this deck. It just makes it so much fun for me to read. It's also so beautiful. Like, come on, it's gorgeous. It's such a missed opportunity for not even the like foiled edges, although the holographic edges would be cool. Even just like a matte purpley blue kind of color. Such a missed opportunity with how glitzy the deck is. Tarot of the Crystal World. This was a Kickstarter, and I don't know if you can buy this. I don't know if it is still in production or if he's got extra copies that he's selling or what. This is one of my favorite decks to come out of last year. I'm sure I mentioned it in my standout decks video. I can't imagine that I wouldn't have done, but my brain has turned to mush, so I don't remember what I talked about in that video. But this is just so cool. It's like comic book art style, but also grungy, but also like cowboys. It's a kind of contrary to the Eldritch Overload, which had that really, really strong, really clear, really fleshed out world building. This feels like you could pick cards that feel like they're from different worlds almost. Like, okay, our Emperor and our King of Cups, like, could be from different worlds, but it works so well. Because it's this like grungy Western. It also is a very, I think that the creator of this is just really cool. I like some of the other projects that he's done. This feels like quite a like inclusive deck. It also feels like a queer deck. I think that was one of the intentions going into it, that it was supposed to feel like quite an inclusive, accessible deck. And I think it's wonderful. I think it's such a good deck. I'm so glad I have this in my collection. And like I say, this is one of my standout decks of last year. I really enjoy reading with this. It's also got some of the yummiest cardstock. It's a linen, and it just shuffles like a dream. All right, the Lubanko Tarot. I've had this for a couple years. This one is sadly out of print. Some of my favorite super shiny gilding on this card, on this deck. This one is sadly out of print. Oh, this is real chipped. I don't remember if this was the final print run or the penultimate print run, but I'm really glad I have a copy. This is an intense deck. This is also a very queer deck, which I love. I love the art style. This is one of my favorite star cards. I think it's beautiful. It's really worth reading with, but I have to take my time reading with this one, and it is not a gentle, easy reader by any stretch of the imagination. I love this Ace of Pentacles. I love it. It pairs really nicely with a few different decks, which is very cool. And it's a really interesting deck because some cards visually look very similar to the Rider-Waite-Smith, and in the little guidebook, some meanings are very adjacent to the Rider-Waite-Smith. I love this Ten of Wands. And then other cards feel completely different. Like, I love this Six of Swords. And this feels like quite like Rider-Waite-Smith with a twist to me. But then certain other cards, like, not so much. It's interesting. Like, where is this Queen of Wands? Like, it's just fantastic. So the Lubanko Tarot, it's an intense deck. but it is one that is well worth the time that it takes for me to read with it. The Raven's Dream Tarot by MJ Cullinane. This is the first printing that she did. And as you will see when we get to my mass market deck collection, I love an MJ Cullinane deck. This is the only indie deck of hers that I've got. I also have the Urban Cry Oracle that you'll have seen last week. I love this. And I bought this so fast. I'm not gonna lie, there wasn't a whole lot of thought that went through my head between getting the email that this existed. I don't know if I even got the email or if I just happened across it somehow. I think I was looking at her website for some other reason, realized that this existed. I am now subscribed to her mailing list, and I pre-ordered it so fast. I love her decks. I love her guidebooks. The art style in this is my favorite of her art. Like I say, I have a few decks, and her art style has been, I'd say it's the same style, but it's obviously been evolving as she's been creating more artwork. And this is my favorite incarnation of her art style so far. I love the colors. I love these turquoise borders. It's this nighttime, hazy, dreamy kind of vibe. This is a dreamscape. This is like a Raven's Dreamscape tarot deck. And the guidebook is really cool. It has this like narrative to it. So each card, we have what is being depicted. Let's see, Seven of Wands. So we have, each card depicts a dream that this raven is having. And so here, the raven dreamt of feeling hungry. Tentacles emerge from the water. Like, we have a paragraph explaining the dream that the raven's having. And then we have another paragraph just with the general meaning of the card. And I really like this guidebook. I really like her mass market guidebooks that I've got as well. Some of these cards don't visually seem obvious because it's this dreamscape. It's this weird and wonderful raven's dream. Like, sometimes I look at the artwork and I'm like, I don't see how that is a, you know, Four of Wands or whatever the case. But then reading the guidebook, it makes a lot of sense and adds to, you know, my little mental library of meanings. And it's really cool to have that kind of storytelling element in the guidebook, because then when I come back to this deck, I have a bit more context for the card and the specific imagery, and coming back to that card like evokes what I've read before. All that to say, this is beautiful. It's this like rose petally finish, but it's not too difficult to shuffle, which is honestly some kind of magic. And I see why everybody loves MJ Cullinane's indie decks, because the quality is delicious. Although I think all of her previous decks have gone mass market, so I would imagine that this one likely will also go mass market, but this cardstock is so much nicer than the Hay House cardstock. Oh, and these are the beautiful, beautiful backs. There is also a walkthrough first impressions of this on my channel as well. I will link those below where, you know, where relevant. These were my last Kickstarter packages of 2023, although I still have some that I'm waiting on, but anyway. These arrived in December. This is the Jupiter Power Tarot by Charlie Quintero, which is their latest deck creation. And I think they're already working on, is it the Neptune Power that I saw on Instagram? But this is very abstract, limited color palette, plant-based deck. Have I played with this yet? No, not really. Because I only got it really recently, so I haven't had the time, quite frankly. But this one has wound up living next to my bed, and I really liked pulling cards kind of in the morning or at night when I just feel like pulling some cards, but I don't really want to read. Like, does that make sense? So something that's, you know, very like very narrative or very Rider Waite Smith based, I'm like, oh god, I don't want to like actually do a reading and have it give me loads of information. I just want to shuffle, pull some cards and kind of look at them. And this deck has been fantastic for that. And I'm not saying that you can't read with it. I'm just saying that I haven't, because as you can see, it's very abstract. The colors also make it perfect for that kind of like chill read and see what pops out kind of reading. But all that said, the guidebook that comes with it, I think, does give you some information on what plant is represented in each card and why that plant was chosen for that card, which is very, very cool. So I do want to actually dive a little bit deeper with this and actually read with this deck. But for the time being, I'm having a good time just pulling cards to see what I get, really. I don't think every time we pull cards, it has to be deep and meaningful and answering burning questions. I like to shuffle, and I like to look at artwork, and this deck has been serving that purpose very well so far. So that was the Kickstarter deck, and then I also got this as an add-on because I wanted this forever. This is the Mars Power Tarot by Charlie Quintero. And this, where this one was kind of abstract and had a lot of space, this one is loud. This one is loud. This one is chaotic. This one is holographic. So it looks outrageous under the lights. Actually, when I read with this, I don't find it that distracting, but under my lighting for filming, it is very, very blingy. Yeah, this is a lot more chaotic. There is a lot more going on in this artwork. There's a lot less empty space. It's very busy, which I like, don't get me wrong. I do enjoy that in a card. I like having lots of things to look at and lots of things to pick out and make meaning from. This is just extremely cool. And again, have I really read with it? No, I haven't had the time, but I will be. And I'm excited to pair this with some things as well. I think that's going to be really fun. I've done a couple of quick pulls with it, and I've been liking a lot of what's popped up. So I'm really looking forward to diving into this a little bit more intentionally as well. Also, these bags are some of my favorite tarot bags of all time. The Ritual Tarot by Tierra May. This is the marked edition, the most recent edition. And there is a unboxing walkthrough first impressions playing with pairs video on my channel. This came in December, so that was relatively recent. And I was so back and forth on whether I wanted the Ritual Tarot in my collection for so long. The price was outrageous. Importing, to me personally, buying a copy from the US and shipping it over to me, the price was too much and I wasn't going to do it. But then this edition has the titles on the back, which I think is done in a really clever way. I keep saying it, but I love how it makes the cards, they just look like art cards because they're borderless, they're titleless. They look like, you know, a fabulous little collection of artwork. And I was able to get this, I think it was a Kickstarter. I didn't back it on Kickstarter, but I ordered it through the Wootique, which is a UK-based indie deck shop. And obviously it was much cheaper for her to buy it in bulk and sell it on than it would be for me to buy a single copy and have it shipped. So it was a price that I could justify. And I'm so glad I have this in my collection. I have been doing some readings with this. I just love it. I just love working with this deck. And I'm so, so glad I have it. And I think this is going to be a really important deck in my collection. Like I said, this was an honorable mention in my standout decks video as like a future hopeful standout, because I'd only just got it at the time of recording that video. But I think this is going to be a really special one. And I'm finishing on this because this is the Princess of Cups. And this is one of my favorite pieces of art in this deck. I just think it's so, so beautiful. So, the Ritual Tarot. All right, we're getting there. This is the Raincoast Tarot. This is another Make Playing Cards deck. And I think I did a walkthrough, first impressions, unboxing situation with this when I first got it. I love the art style. I think it's really cool. It's kind of weird and wonderful. I have not read with this. Not at all. I have read with it, but I kind of pull it out. I do a reading. I put it straight back away, whereas usually I'll keep a deck out and kind of, you know, keep working with it for an amount of time. But this one, hasn't clicked with me yet, and I don't know whose fault that is. Like, I don't know if it's just not going to click with me, or I don't know if I need to use it more and figure out, because I love it. I love the art style, but the thing that gets in my way is, like, look at this Three of Pentacles. It's weird, it's wonderful, there's a lot going on, it's chaotic. We've got trees growing out of faces, we've got all sorts of stuff happening. And the Pentacle suit and the Cup suit are both like that. And then look at the Nine of Swords, which is a very kind of, it's a stylized Nine of Swords, but it's very pared back. There's not too much going on. Like, they're just completely different vibes. Although the art style is obviously the same because it's the same artist, like, they feel like two different reading experiences. And I find that quite jarring to read with. Like, here, the cups are weird and wonderful. We have this face cup. We have this river that's also a person. We have someone peeking out from behind a tree. Like, there's so much going on. There's this king bat upside down guy. Like, there's so much happening. And then the wands, which are candles in his deck. The wands are just a Rider Waite Smith clone. Like, I don't know how I feel about it all. And that's been getting in my way, unfortunately. So, oh, this judgment is so cool. Like, it's so cool, but, like, I just don't understand why the swords and the wand suits are so kind of, like, in comparison to some of the other cards that have all these details and have this kind of, like, surreal artwork to them. Like, this feels like it was rushed, or, like, they just don't feel like they're from the same deck. Anyway, I'm gonna quit complaining, but the artwork is really cool. I just need to either figure out how it's gonna work for me or decide to move it along, because, as you can tell, I have a lot of decks. I finally found my other Tarot Collectibles decks. These were in tuck boxes, so they're at the bottom. This is the Winter Waite Redux Stars Edition, which I recently put away, actually, because it's very Christmassy and it's now January. Again, the stars are not as distracting in real life as they are under the lights. It's just the way I got my lights angled. It really picks up on anything shiny. This is just sticky or staticky? Staticky. It's like pastel goodness, Christmas. Like, it's cute. It's cute. It's fun. I read with this a lot over the festive period because it's cute and fun and it's easy to read because it's a Rider Waite Smith clone. There's not too much more to say about it. I love, we got a little present instead of the globe. Like, it is quite Christmassy rather than just wintry. Like, we've got Father Christmas in here. We've got Jack Frost instead of Death. Like, we've got Christmas presents and Santa Claus and specifically Christmas references, like, here rather than just wintry, which is, you know, it's fine. I don't personally, I celebrate Christmas by default, you know? It's like, well, I live in England. I'm not Christian, but I'm not religious. So it's like that cultural Christianity thing. It's like, yes, of course I do Christmas presents. So, like, it doesn't bother me that it's Christmassy, but just, I guess, to point out, because it's called the Winter Waite, but it is more of a Christmas Waite. But it's very, very cute, and I love having it in my collection. I think this one, quite a few of my Tarot Collectibles decks, actually, I got off their eBay as, like, it's a sample deck. This one is, and I know that a few of the others that I've got, I bought them as, like, sample decks instead of full price decks from their shop. So it's possible that things like the cardstock or little design things are different to the, like, official copies that you'd buy in their shop. But I mean, all 78 cards are there, so personally I'm happy. And then my final Tarot Collectibles is the Blacklight Tarot, which is, as you can guess from the name, it's another neon one, like the psychedelic space that I had. These are some of my favourite tarot backs ever, and it's just fantastic. It is similar vein to the Groovy Waite, to the Trippin Waite, but it's black backgrounds and UV reactive neon colours. And I think it's just such a feast for the eyes. Like, I definitely have several very similar decks from Tarot Collectibles, but like, they're so cool. They're so cool. And again, I know the camera isn't picking up the colours as vibrant as they are, but like, this is fantastic. The hair and the Queen of Pentacles, like, it is that kind of Groovy vibes, but with UV reactive neon colours. I love this death card because this child with the sunglasses on just looks so unbothered. Anyways, that is the Blacklight Tarot. Oh my god, we're down to the final three decks. This is amazing. So this here is the Art of Adventure Tarot, which I got off of Etsy. And I'm honestly not sure if it's still available or not. So this is really cool, but kind of similar to the Rain Coast. I don't reach for this and I don't really know why. Not similar to the Rain Coast, because I know why I don't reach for the Rain Coast. It's because it doesn't feel like a cohesive deck. This is a cohesive deck. The art style is really cool. It's really, really close to the Rider-Waite Smith. But some of the cards have like even more like added depth with the art style that they've gone with. Like, it's really effectively done. It's a Rider-Waite Smith base deck, but the art style adds to the meaning instead of being one of those decks where things feel forced to show the meaning. I hope that makes sense. I know that when I did the series of like my favorite swords cards, my favorite cups cards in response to Livy at Crescent Dreams Tarot, I pulled these cards a lot because I think they're such good, like, they're such good depictions of the cards. But for some reason, I don't read with this deck, and I do not know why. I really don't know why. But it's very cool. It's a very clear reader. It's definitely like summery vibes. So maybe I'll pull it out again in the summer. And I love the way all the shadows have like a blue tint. Like, I just think visually it's so, so cool. So, and like this, like, biblically accurate angel, like, not exactly, but it's this like alien kind of vibe for the angels. Yeah, it's really cool. Okay, my final two indie decks go together because they literally arrived together. And that is the Terra Arcanae and the Oceanum Arcanae by Taylor Brin. So I got these last year on Kickstarter. This Terra Arcanae was the newer one. And then I added on the Oceanum Arcanae. So I have them both. She is doing a fire deck and an air deck. And because I'm a sucker and because I have two, like, I'm almost definitely getting the other two to complete the collection. But this is the Terra Arcanae. The Earth Tarot is all mammals, I think. And first of all, I love her art style. It is kind of grungy in a way that I really like, with all of the pen marks. I just think she's a really talented artist. And in terms of this being a tarot deck, I think it's really clever how, although this is the Earth deck and they're all mammals, I think the way the different suits have been devised is really clever. Like, I think it shows up particularly in the... Oh, so it was a volcano in the Dinosaur Marseille, wasn't it? It was a volcano, and then this is like an asteroid. That's clever. I interrupted myself. I think it is in the court cards that it shows up best, but like for the swords, the air suit, we have bats. So it's mammals, but they are flying mammals. And we've got burrowers for the pentacles courts. Like, it's just really effective. It's really clever. It's obviously very intentional in the way that it's done. So this is the earth suit. I'm like, oh, cute little page of swords. Oh, I love it. I also like how she's done the Wheel of Fortune in this. I forget what it's called, but this is the Mayan calendar, isn't it? Yes, it was the... loosely based on the appearance of a Mayan calendar representing the Wheel of Fortune. And then the Oceanum Arcanae, the Ocean Tarot, is obviously going to look very similar because it is the same artist. It's an animal deck by the same artist. I love this penguin, Seven of Cups, with the little penguin ghost up here. I think it's wonderful. But even here, like, everything is an ocean dweller, but there are distinctions in the suits. And off the top of my head, I forget exactly how that's been done. But, like, this lovely otter for the Queen of Pentacles. So I think what she went for here was not fish, but, like, ocean water creatures. And then this death card is a... This is a like a myth or a folktale, and I think this is a Japanese one, but I could well be wrong. And then this ancient clock that was discovered on a shipwreck or just in the ocean as a Wheel of Fortune, which again I think is really clever. But yeah, like we've got sharks for the sword courts. It's adorable little Ace of Cups. Like, I just think it's really cleverly done. And I love me an animal deck, which you will know if you watched my Please Don't Look at Me decks without people in them video. I've got quite a few animal decks, and I used to say that I wasn't an animal deck person, so that was clearly a lie. But anyhow, that is the Oceanum Arcanae. So that is everything. That is all of the indie tarot decks and a bonus Marseille that are in my collection as of the very start of 2024. I guess the general idea is that I'll do another round of these videos in a year's time at the start of 2025 to see where my collection's at. It's a bit of an inventory of my current collection, but I have been talking for such a very long time, and if you've made it this far, you've been watching for such a very long time. So thank you so much for watching. I really do hope you've enjoyed it. Like I've said before, these collection videos are a bit of a guilty pleasure of mine to watch. There's just something really cozy, and also I'm a very nosy person and I want to see what everybody has. So if you are like that, you're welcome. I hope you've enjoyed, and next week is going to be my mass market tarot decks. And with that, I will leave you. Give me a like if you liked it and subscribe if you haven't already, and I will see you in the next one. Bye-bye.